Thank you. I like to talk about what I think is a big problem, and that is the healthcare tsunami that's occurring because of a decline in cognitive function with aging. If we look at the ability of people to live longer in our society is really quite staggering. In 2009, just in the United States alone, we had about 39 million people greater than 65. In 2030, we will have greater than 72 million individuals greater than 65 in the United States, which would make up about 19% of the population. And that's just continuing to grow. A child born in the United States today will have about a 1 in 3 probability of actually living to 100. And that's great. And it's really good. But the problem with that is that we actually begin to lose cognitive function at about the age of 30. So as we grow older, even if we don't get any sort of dementia, our cognitive function is just going to be declining with age. So that by the time you get 80, you're going to have a significant decline in your ability to reason and to think. And to add on top of that, the actual pathological dementias becomes an even greater problem. So we have the problem of cognitive decline associated with just normal aging. But on top of that, we have Alzheimer's, which makes up about 70% of all dementias. And then we have other types of dementias associated with aging, vascular dementia, dementia associated with Parkinson's, Lewy body dementia, frontal temporal dementia, and so forth. Now, all of these diseases are just inevitable. The older you get, the more likely you are to get them. And it's just a matter of time. So that if we actually look at some of the facts, about 1 in 8 individuals greater than 65 living in America has Alzheimer's disease. About 50% of individuals that are 85 years old who have a risk factor of Alzheimer's, a first-degree relative of one of the genetic alleles for Alzheimer's, will have Alzheimer's disease by the age of 80. In 2012, we spent $200 billion on healthcare for Alzheimer's. And if no treatment is developed, Alzheimer's alone will bankrupt the healthcare system in a very short period of time. Despite spending billions of dollars in research for dementia, all of the current approaches have failed. This is a major, major issue with Big Pharma. Big Pharma actually spends the second largest amount in trying to find a treatment for Alzheimer's of any other disease. Cancer is number one. Alzheimer's is number two. Cardiovascular disease is sort of a distant third. And the reason that all of these approaches have failed is that we actually now don't have the ability to appropriately diagnose Alzheimer's. The way that we diagnose Alzheimer's is with the cognitive test that's focused primarily on loss of memory, loss of cognitive function. And the problem is that by the time you actually get cognitive decline, you know, you forget how to get to your friend's house that you've been going to for 15 years, you've already lost about 50% of your brain cells. So the disease has actually been developing for about 20 years before you become symptomatic. So that by the time you actually make a diagnosis, you're actually looking at a very advanced stage of the disease. So the way that I look at this is as if you go to your doctor and you have diabetes and you've had it for 20 years and now you present with end-stage kidney failure and your doctor says, oh, we should try to treat your glucose. That's good, but it's probably not going to do a whole lot for you. So in order for us to have success, we need to have the ability to diagnose Alzheimer's really at its early stage, 20 years before it causes significant destruction and loss of brain function. Now, the hallmark of Alzheimer's is really two things. One is the development of an abnormal protein called beta amyloid, and the other is these tangled neurofilaments that occurs inside the neurons. Now, beta amyloid, which is the hallmark, actually begins to develop in the brain about 20 years before you become clinically symptomatic from Alzheimer's. It's the first thing that changes. You know, after that, you begin seeing some synaptic dysfunction. You begin seeing about 10 years later some changes in the neurofibrillary tangles. You get the cognitive decline about 20 years later, and then symptomatic decline after that. So what we really need is a way of diagnosing the increase in these abnormal amyloid proteins 20 years before someone becomes symptomatic, so that we actually have a shot at therapeutic intervention. We've attempted to do this with PET scans, for example, with targets, with positrons for amyloid. The problem with PET is that it has very low resolution. It's kind of an all-or-none phenomenon. It's expensive. It's radioactive. It's limited. You can have a spinal tap, but I don't think many 50-year-olds are going to voluntarily subject themselves to a spinal tap to screen for amyloid in their CSF. So what we really need is a simple, reliable, non-invasive test that we can diagnose this disease at the early stage. So the eye is really a window to the brain. The retina in the back of the eye is an extension of the brain embryonically. And we asked a question then, why will you not be able to identify amyloid in the back of the retina? And if you can, then can you diagnose Alzheimer's simply by looking through the eye? So it turns out that curcumin, which is the ingredient in turmeric, which is the yellow in the Indian spice, crosses the blood-brain barrier. It crosses the blood-retina barrier. And actually, it binds with high affinity to the beta amyloid plaque, particularly the A-beta 42, which is the most toxic amyloid. And also, curcumin is a fluorochrome, so it actually generates a fluorescent signal. So hypothetically, you should be able to give curcumin. And if the plaques are in the retina, you can sort of use retinal imaging and special filters to be able to see these amyloid plaques in the back of the retina. And we looked at transgenic mice that are predisposed to developing Alzheimer's. And actually, about 2.5 years ago, with the special retinal scan, saw these plaques in a living mouse. So this is a wild-type mice, non-transgenic, optic disc, the retina. And this is transgenic Alzheimer's mice. And you can see these little spots of the amyloid plaque fluorescing with the curcumin after a dose of curcumin in the tail vein. So we got very excited about this because this would potentially give us a non-invasive way of diagnosing Alzheimer's by looking through the eye. The question is, it's a mouse. So does it really occur in man? So we then got a cadaver sample of well-characterized brains that had been characterized for Alzheimer's that also had the eyes saved. And we correlated the amount of amyloid in the brain to the amyloid in the retina of those patients. And what we found that in the normal non-Alzheimer's patients looking at the retina, we did not find any of these amyloid plaques. But in patients that had Alzheimer's, the amount of amyloid load in the retina had a very close correlation to the amount of amyloid load in the brain. And in fact, you can go from mild cognitive impairment with less amyloid load, and even in patients that had not been diagnosed with Alzheimer's disease, and it just had some mild cognitive impairment, we could even see in those patients the amyloid in the eye. So we then asked the question, that's great in a cadaver, but can you actually do it in a living person? So about a year ago, we started a pilot study where we modified a retinal imaging scanner that you would find in your ophthalmologist's office. We gave patients an oral dose of curcumin in a form that actually got absorbed in the GI system, because most curcumin doesn't get absorbed, less than 1%. So we modified the curcumin so it got absorbed into the blood and into the retina. We gave them this in a chocolate pudding, and we looked at both normal controls and Alzheimer's patients. So this is what the eye looked like in a normal volunteer. You can see the optic disc. You're not seeing any of those little plaques that we saw in the mice. And this is what an Alzheimer's patient looks like. So you can see the disc would be up here, and you can see these little plaques of amyloid accumulating just like you would see in the brain. And the beauty of this is that this is in the resolution of microns. So unlike a PET scan, you know, that's about 1,000 times less resolution, you're seeing the individual plaque as if you would do a biopsy and look pathologically at the sample. We started using special imaging processing so we could bring out even finer detail in the retina, seeing even small sort of plaques accumulating. We did some digital processing and imaging so that we could develop a quantitative technique of this. And you know, this shows, for example, a normal patient, a patient with mild Alzheimer's disease, moderate Alzheimer's disease with more plaques, and this is a patient with vascular dementia, which is not associated with amyloid accumulation that had mistakenly been diagnosed as Alzheimer's, but they actually don't have Alzheimer's because you don't see the amyloid plaque. We've developed some quantitative algorithms to actually develop what we call an amyloid index by doing digital processing of the increased fluorescence in the plaques. You can actually quantitate this using sort of heat mapping and heat screens to give you what we call an amyloid, a retinal amyloid index number. What we've done is mathematically, you know, sort of picked out each one of these individual spots that's actually above the threshold value at baseline, the increased fluorescence of the curcumin, to try to correlate this index with the development of early Alzheimer's in patients. This is the results of a pilot study, and you can see our normal volunteers, and this is the increased amyloid index in patients with Alzheimer's. So potentially, this could be a 20-minute test that you can get when you go to your ophthalmologist for your regular eye exam, and it can be performed as part of a routine eye exam on essentially everybody my age, over 50. So what if we can detect Alzheimer's 20 years before it's symptomatic, right? We don't have the insulin like we do for diabetes yet, so you know, why give someone bad news? Well, a couple of reasons. One is that all of the current treatments fail because we're trying to treat the end stage. So we're much more likely to develop a therapeutic solution if we can start early than if we're treating late stage disease. Individuals that are increasing their amyloid would have the opportunity to enroll in promising clinical trials. The beauty of this is that we can also monitor whether the amyloid is decreasing with the retinal amyloid testing. In our transgenic mouse models, we can actually see these plaques decrease in real time with therapeutic intervention. You can also begin using generally regarded as safe therapies, GRAS therapies, that have some scientific evidence for being beneficial in slowing the progress of the disease now before we get an FDA-approved drug. Indians eat a lot of turmeric, which contains curcumin. Some people think that the lower incidence of Alzheimer's in India is related to the increase curcumin in the diet. There are clinical trials that are currently underway using curcumin to treat Alzheimer's. And in transgenic models of Alzheimer's, curcumin has sometimes as much of a beneficial effect as some of the therapeutic drugs that are being developed. Fisetin, green tea, exercise, brain exercise, is coffee. I've already had at least 2 cups this morning. And the beauty of this is that most of my career, I've really focused on trying to treat brain cancer, which is really hard. But here, the only thing that we need to do is to slow down the slope of the curve so that if you're developing cognitive decline at 30, the disease is starting at 50, and you're going to get memory loss at 70, just slowing down this curve so that you get memory loss at 105 could potentially eliminate the clinical phase of the disease for most people in the population. So we can develop the technology to do this now. A solution would not only save trillions of healthcare dollars, but could potentially give one the ability to live out our senior lives with a higher quality, and that could be priceless. And so, you know, we hope that this will be a useful technology. Thank you.